Okay, so it's a pleasure to introduce Professor Mahan Maharaj. He's a professor at Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai. And just to tell you new guys that, you know, he's an expert in hyperbolic geometry, group theory, geometry, and many other areas. And like he's recipient of this prestigious Bhatnagar Award, Infosys Prize for the Mathematical Sciences, and all, he's an immensely popular speaker. He's a wonderful speaker. So we are grateful to Professor Mahan for agreeing with our invitation and immediately getting ready to give a talk for us. Professor Mahan Maharaj.
Yeah, so thanks Kalyan. Thanks Pranav for taking care of all this. So, and it's a real pleasure. I wish I could have been there in KSOM. I'd visited there earlier this year and it was very pleasant, very pleasant. And thanks for this very kind introduction. But the trouble with kind introductions is that one, expectations of the audience are raised. So, I mean, if I do not live up to those expectations, I cannot blame myself. All right. So, here is the thing. So, I'll be talking about percolation on hyperbolic groups. And don't worry if you don't know any of these terms. I'll try to say what these things mean. Before we start, I just should say that all of this is joint with Riddhi Pratim Basu, who's a probabilist. And so the subject lies at the interface between probability and hyperbolic geometry. Okay? So percolation is from probability, hyperbolic groups is from hyperbolic geometry. So what I'll do is now first define percolation. And I am pretty new to this stuff, so I'll definitely go do elementary stuff as far as experts are concerned, but we'll try to introduce this and say how to think about it. Okay, so what is percolation? So percolation starts with a pretty naive, simple-minded model. Suppose you're on, you're in some two-dimensional, it's say the floor of your room, yeah? And at some point you keep splashing water, yeah? Then the water will flow, it will percolate through the floor and it will reach different paths. Now the water blob is not going to be something very regular, right? So essentially the point is this is not a deterministic experiment because there are far, far too many parameters. And so you can't deterministically say where the water will be. However, each part of the flow will have some resistance to the water flowing. So if it was completely smooth, the water will keep flowing like a circular patch. Now that never happens in practice. So therefore, there is some kind of probabilistic model that is asked for. And essentially, percolation, which was started in the 1950s, thereabouts, was started in order to model mathematically precisely this flow of liquids in a medium. Yeah, typically in 2D, it could also be percolation of water in some three-dimensional porous medium. And so being a geometric group theorist by training, we'll try to discretize the problem. And discretizing this problem is also a very natural thing to do. So what does one do? Assume essentially you have a network of pipes and you allow some water to come in through one place and then the water will flow through the pipes. And these pipes are like a grid in some space. So how fast does the water reach a point? Yeah, that's the kind of problem that we are trying to address. So let's try to make that formal and precise. So this network of pipes that I was mentioning, this is going to be modeled by some graph. Yeah, some graph. And for us, for the purposes of this lecture, the graphs will be locally finite, uniformly bounded valence. Yeah. So what does valence mean? It means the number of edges that are incident on a particular vertex. So you have a vertex set of the graph, you have an edge set of the graph, and the two put together is your graph gamma. All right. And now what you want to say is that essentially, so these edges are placeholders for these pipes. Yeah. So each pipe, some of those pipes might be narrow, some of them might be thick, which means that some of them will allow water to pass through fast, some of them will allow water to pass through slowly. Now that's not the kind of model that we want to go in for. We basically want to say that the pipes are essentially identical. However, there is some kind of flux that goes on. So the pipes at every point of time, all the pipes are not uniform in amount of water that they pass through. But on an average, they have the same kind of behavior. It's like just buying a bunch of pipes from the market. So they all have some kind of probability. So essentially, the amount of water that can flow through a particular edge, placeholder for a segment of a pipe, now has a probability distribution on it. Yeah? Essentially, how are we going to think of this? Think of this as the pipes become longer or shorter. If it's short, the water will percolate fast. If it becomes long, then the water will percolate through that pipe slowly. So you think of this as a probability distribution on R plus. R plus is a set of, now it's you convert it entirely into this graph terminology. So you have this graph. Typically, we'll be dealing with infinite graphs. And each edge now has a length which varies according to this probability distribution. Yeah. So each edge is assigned a length from R plus. For some reason, I have put a closed bracket next to infinity. We'll not really be dealing with the point where, with the case where the length is actually infinite, which means that the water does not percolate. We'll not really deal with that. So for us, really the kind of probability distributions you should think of are continuous probability distributions on the set of positive real numbers. Yeah. So that means an edge now takes a length between zero and infinity, strictly between zero and infinity. And the way it takes that length is determined by this probability distribution. Good. Now, this is for a particular edge. What if you put all the edges together? Then you get your underlying probability space of all possible graph lengths. Yeah. So which means it is R plus comma rho. And this is taken product with itself, number of edge many times. So if there's a single edge, you're just going to get R plus comma rho. If you have two edges, you're going to get R plus comma rho cross R plus comma rho. So each edge is going to be assigned a length according to the probability rho, and these lengths are going to be assigned independently. What length you assign to some other edge is not going to matter when you assign length to another edge. Yeah. So two different edges get lengths assigned independently. Okay. So now you can basically think of, what exactly is going on? So essentially a point in your capital omega P, what does it do? It's going to assign for you a length to every edge. So basically you think of this top line omega P equal to R plus comma rho whole to the E. Now this is a function from E to R plus, right? And the probability distribution, so it's a probability distribution on some function space. So typically our edges, the cardinality of the edge set will be infinite. What does that mean? So you're going to each point in this space is going to assign a length to every edge, which means what has happened is that your graph, which was a priori just a simplicial object or a topological object, has now become a geometric or metric object. Yeah. So edges have lengths. Yeah. Each point of capital omega, which is little omega, what does it do? It eats an edge of the graph and spits out a length. So as a result, what do you have? You have metric graphs parameterized by your probability measure space. So each point in your probability measure space assigns for you a length to every edge in your graph. So essentially, one way you can think of this is for those of you who are familiar with bundles or say, so what is happening is that you have a fiber. The fiber is this graph gamma. A priori does not have any extra structure. But as you change your base point, what happens is that the lengths on the graph, lengths of every edge potentially change. So the slogan really is that viewed this way, percolation is geometry of graphs, but the parameterization space is a probability measure space. So even more salesmanish way of saying the same thing is that it's geometric group theory parameterized by probability. Yeah. So the parameterization probability space is this omega P, and the fibers are graphs. And now those guys have geometries. Okay, very good. So I'll say what exactly the statement is for classical geometric group theory. Let me say it now and I'll come back to it in the next slide. essentially when the probability distribution is a Dirac mass concentrated at one, which means with probability one, every edge is assigned length one. Yeah, that means there's just one graph and all edges are of length one. This is the classical setup of geometric group theory. Here, what we are doing is we are making that a little more fuzzy, and we are allowing, instead of a Dirac mass concentrated at a point, we are allowing the probability to be some probability distribution on R plus. Okay, what was this doing? It was essentially viewing capital omega as functions from the edge set to R plus. Therefore, a point little omega was eating an edge, spitting out a length. On the there's a reverse way of thinking about it, where each edge, now you allow your parameter, so the point in the parameter space, to vary over omega. Yeah. In the first picture, first way of looking at it, what were you doing? You were fixing on little omega and you were allowing your edges to vary. Now, what are you going to do? You fix your edge and think of this capital X sub E now as a function from your parameterization space to your target space, which is R plus. So what does it do? This variable, right, this XE, what does it do? It eats a point of your probability measure space and again spits out a length, right? So earlier, little omega was eating an edge and spitting out a length. This is just the opposite. A variable corresponding to an edge eats a point of the probability measure space and spits out a length. So that means, so these are all, so random variable just means a measurable function. Measurable function on a probability space is also called a random variable. So this guy is, this random variable is X sub E. So what was the statement that we were assigning lengths independently and with the same distribution rho? It means basically that this is in the probability literature, it's called IID. Independent, first I stands for independent and second stands for identically distributed. Identically distributed, and the probability distribution for this independent for this identical distribution is the probability distribution that we started off with, namely rho. Okay. So basically what is happening is that essentially if you fix your attention on an edge, capital X sub E is essentially lengths of edges parameterized by your probability measure space, capital omega. Yeah. So this kind of thing, this is a particular random variable. You can, the way to think of it is, it's a random edge, which means it's an edge, but the lengths are varying. So now once you have assigned a random length to an edge, which means a length depending on a probability distribution, what you can do is now you can sum these guys over edge paths. Yeah. So now you fix an edge path, which means that there's a sequence of edges, finite sequence of edges, E1 through EK, such that the end of E1 is the beginning of E2. Yeah. Once you have such a guy, what happens for any little omega belonging to your probability measure space? Now that is going to assign for you a length to every edge. Hence, it's going to assign a length to this edge path. What do you do? You simply sum up the lengths of the particular edges. So each edge path now gives you a length, which means in our language, this random language, every edge path, deterministic every edge path gamma belonging to this capital gamma, which was some simplicial or topological object, now gives you a random length, which means a length parameterized by your probability measure space, capital omega. It's not that every little omega now gives you a length for every edge path. Good. Once you have lengths assigned to edge paths, you can take an infimum over them and define the infimum over all possible edge paths. Now you're allowing your edge paths to vary, but you're keeping your base point fixed, base point little omega in your probability measure space fixed. You take the infimum over all these guys and you're going to get a distance. Yeah. So there is some very minor condition which basically says that this infimum is actually realized and it's realized uniquely. So this guy gives you a distance for every little omega. Therefore, your graph that you started off with is now being converted into a metric space. So what is happening is that for each little omega in the base space, in the probability measure space, you have a distance d sub omega, which is the fastest way to go from x to y with that particular metric. Yeah? So this is a metric parameterized by a probability measure space. According to our convention, this is what we shall call a random metric. A random metric is not a single metric. It's a family of metrics parameterized by a probability measure space. So this is the way we use this language of random. Okay. So this is d omega. So this is true for, you get a distance for every pair of points, triangle inequality, all that's very easy to check. And so you're going to get a family of metric spaces parameterized by your probability guy. So you get a random metric space where the underlying topological or simply shell space is gamma. Fine. You don't just get a metric. I mentioned that under very mild conditions, this infimum is actually realized. So the infimum is not just a distance. The infimum is actually realized by some kind of an edge path. So you spit out not just a number, you also spit out a geometric object, namely an edge path, which happens to be a geodesic in that particular metric. So this letter, before we wrote this paper, I did not know what this letter was supposed to be called. So apparently it's called epsilon. So this epsilon xy, what does it do? It eats a point in your probability measure space, little omega, and what it spits out is the path realizing the infimum, the distance. Yeah. So this is a geodesic in the metric given by little omega on gamma, and there's a specific edge path. So this edge path is called the omega geodesic between x and y. So you can think of this now as a random geodesic. What does that mean? A family of geodesics parameterized by your probability measure space. Now the randomness has a particular model, namely what we've talked about already. That means that the edges are assigned lengths according to a probability distribution, which is IID. Yeah. So this particular random geometry model is called an FPP. Model, first passage percolation. First passage just means when is the first time water percolates from point X to point Y? And what is the path it follows? The path it follows is the FPP geodesic with the metric coming from little omega. Very good. Now, this is the geodesic, but you can think now, if you think of your distance now as a time of passage, then you get another random variable, TXY, which spits out with each measure, it's a point of your probability measure space and spits out the distance. So this is called the first passage, time between X and Y. Now I think we are in a position to state our problem. This particular model had been initiated for Z2. What is the graph associated to Z2? The standard two-dimensional grid on the plane, yeah? So there's a point for, there's a vertex for every a comma b integers, and two such vertices are joined if they are either vertically one above the other at distance one, or horizontally either to the left or to the right at distance one. Yeah. So it's a standard grid that you see. Yeah. So that's the grid. That's the two-dimensional grid. There are n-dimensional generalizations for these models. This had been studied in considerable detail from the 1950s onwards. And there are lots of problems, and this is closely related to statistical physics, et cetera, et cetera. However, what we'll do in this particular lecture is to study this in a different background geometry from Euclidean. And so we come to the other word in our title, namely hyperbolic groups. So what is a hyperbolic group? So I had mentioned that we'll come back to this later. So you think that your probability distribution is a Dirac mass, which is supported at the point one belonging to zero infinity. What does that mean? Every edge is assigned length one. This is the setup of geometric group theory, where a graph becomes a metric space as soon as you assign length one to every edge. So this is what we'll call the deterministic setup. However, we'll not just deal with any old graph. We'll deal with a special class of graphs. So these are called Cayley graphs. So far what has happened is that we started off with there was some component which is probabilistic. This Dirac mass essentially gives us a geometric setup which converts a graph, a combinatorial object, into a geometric object, namely a metric graph. But here we are going to introduce a little bit of algebra or group theory, where the graph is not any old graph, but the graph comes with some amount of symmetry. Yeah. What symmetry? The symmetry is coming from a group. So you start with a group G and a finite generating set S. Yeah. So basically that means every element in G can be written as a product of elements of capital S. S is finite. So for example, if you look at this group Z plus Z, and you look at A inverse, B inverse, then every word is of the form A power M, B power N. So every element of the group can be written as a product of elements of A and B. So then A inverse, B inverse is your generating set. So this is your generating set. And now you construct again a graph out of it, where the vertices correspond exactly to the elements of the group. And the edge set consists of pairs G, H, such that they differ by a generator. Okay. This is your Cayley graph. So now we have three components. You have a probabilistic component, you have a geometric component coming from length, plus you have symmetries of this graph given by group theory. All right. Now we'll put extra geometric conditions, and this is where hyperbolicity comes in. So a geodesic metric space is just a space where any two points can be joined by a path realizing the distance. Such a path is called a geodesic. So a geodesic metric space is said to be delta hyperbolic if given any triple of points x, y, z, as you have three points in your space, you can join them by geodesics, right? You can join x and y by a geodesic, you can join y and z by a geodesic, you can join z and x by a geodesic, which means what? You get a geodesic triangle. Yeah. So as soon as you have straight lines, you can construct triangles. That's all. And hyperbolicity, what does it say? It basically says that every edge lies inside the delta neighborhood of the union of the other two sides. So this is something that is very different from our Euclidean space. In Euclidean space, there is no such delta. Why? You give me a delta. So typically delta here is something that you should think of as very large. So suppose you give me a delta, 10,000. And I construct an equilateral triangle on the plane whose sides are 10,000 multiplied by 10. So you give me any number M, I construct an equilateral triangle, which is 10M. Each side is 10M. So then no side is going to be contained in the M neighborhood of the union of the other two. So all triangles in the Euclidean plane are really fat. Yeah. So there is no delta which functions for all triangles. Here the crucial thing is that it is supposed to function, this delta is supposed to be uniform over all possible triangles. So what is an example of such a hyperbolic geodesic metric space? And the answer is, these are trees. So in a tree, if you assign every edge, the tree is exactly the opposite. In fact, in a tree, what happens is that, a tree is an opposite case where delta is actually zero. For example, if you have three points A, B, C on a tree, then what happens is that the edge A, B is actually contained. So there's some point at which the edge from A to C, the geodesic path from A to C is going to come away from the path from A to B, and then it goes off in a different direction. So basically, triangles in a tree look like the English letter Y or the English letter T. Yeah. The three endpoints are little A, little B, little C. And so what happens is that every edge is actually contained in the union of the other two sides. And the union of the other two sides means it's a zero neighborhood of the union of the other two sides. So a tree is delta hyperbolic with delta the smallest possible, namely zero. Yeah. So this is an instance of something that is hyperbolic. So now this is what negative curvature for graphs really means. Hyperbolicity is the same thing as negative curvature, but it's abstracted out and stated for geodesic metric spaces. When do you say that a group is hyperbolic? If a Cayley graph, which we said was this geometric object associated with the group, if such a Cayley graph is hyperbolic, we say that the group is hyperbolic. And a basic fact says that if it's, so the definition is that it's hyperbolic if it is hyperbolic with respect to some finite generating set. And a theorem due to Gromov basically says that if it is hyperbolic with respect to some finite generating set, it's hyperbolic with respect to any finite generating set. And the thing is that such groups are, they occur all over the place, all over the place. Yeah, so basically there is some kind of a model in which says that, okay, there's a fairly precise statement, but I won't go into that now, that if you pick a group at random, according to some rules, then chances are that you're going to hit a hyperbolic group. So now I think we have introduced the two main terms in our talk, percolation and hyperbolic groups. And now we can ask for a problem which tries to put these two things together. And the problem is study first passage percolation on hyperbolic groups. Yeah. This is the title of my talks, right? So percolation on hyperbolic groups. Hyperbolic groups. Now, what will happen is that the hyperbolic group is no longer going to remain a deterministic object, but the edges are going to fluctuate in length, yeah, according to a probability distribution. And then as the edge length varies, you're going to study various geometric objects associated with that, where the geometric objects are going to be parameterized by your probability measure space. Yeah. So what are the kind of things that you're interested in? Essentially, random geodesics. So what is a geodesic between a pair of points parameterized now by your probability measure space? Yeah. And the basic kind of philosophy in this is essentially asking, how far does it deviate from the deterministic setup where all the edges are assigned length one? That's our problem. Good. So before we get into that problem, I'll try to make some noises about where you see hyperbolic groups all over the place. I said, mentioned the example of trees. So this picture at the bottom, where you have a tree, where you have this red edge is labeled A, the blue edge going up vertically is labeled B. So this is a Cayley graph. This tree down here is really a Cayley graph of the free group on two generators. So essentially you have E going to A to the right, E going to A inverse to the left, E going to B to the in the top, E going to B inverse down. And then what you're going to do is you're just going to compose these guys, A, B, A inverse and B inverse, with only the proviso that A and A inverse do not occur next to each other, B and B inverse do not occur next to each other. That way you'll get all the elements of your group, and the Cayley graph is going to be what is staring at you from there. It's a regular four-valent tree, okay? And on the top, we have actually given two other examples. So the two examples at the top, some of you might have seen, there is this painting paintings by Maurice Escher, yeah? And what happens is that there's this large stuff in the middle, which becomes smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller as you go away from the center. This is happening because the intrinsic geometry of the unit disk, that happens to be hyperbolic. So just for completeness, let me say that the metric there is something like the Euclidean metric. And in the denominator, you have 1 minus r square. R is the Euclidean radius, whole square. So basically you look at the Euclidean metric, scale it by 1 minus r square whole square, and you're going to get the hyperbolic metric. The stuff on the right is a very interesting thing. This actually is a group. See, there is lots of symmetries on the picture at the top right. Yeah. Why is that? So basically you have these triangles. Now what are the angles of the triangle? Just at the center, there are 12 triangles. So 12 triangles, all of which have the same angle there. So that means what is the angle for each triangle there at that vertex? It's 2 pi divided by 12, which is pi by 6. Now you look at the next guy. So there are 4 triangles there. So that means 2 pi divided by 4, which is pi by 2. And look at the third vertex. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 8 guys. So 2 pi divided by 8, which is pi by 4. So what are the angles of a triangle here in this round picture, in this hyperbolic plane here? They are pi by 6, pi by 4, and pi by 2. you sum up the angles and that comes to less than 180 degrees. It comes to less than pi. Yeah, basically 1 by 6 plus 1 by 4 is equal to 3 plus 2 by 12, which is 5 by 12, which is strictly less than 6 by 12, which is half. Yeah. So the sum of the angles of the triangle is less than 180 degrees. This is really how hyperbolic geometry was discovered. So basically find a model, basically find axioms where the sum of the angles of a, keep the rest of the axioms of Euclidean geometry intact and change the parallel postulate. The parallel postulate is equivalent to the statement that the sum of the angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. Now you introduce, change that and say that the sum of the angles of a triangle is strictly less than 180 degrees. And what you get is what is what has now just popped out. And this is how Gauss actually discovered hyperbolic geometry way back, yeah, 1824 thereabouts. Okay. And then I think formally this was, there were papers by Lobachevsky and Bolyai, which were the first published papers on hyperbolic geometry. Okay. So this has actually a group structure on it. Essentially, you introduce reflections on the three edges. So reflections means a square equal to identity, b square equal to identity, c square equal to identity. Then around the element that the vertex where there are 12 guys, what you're saying is ab whole power 6 is equal to identity. The other guy where there are 4, it is bc whole square is equal to identity. The place where there are 8 is ca whole power 4 is equal to identity. So you're going to get a group and the Cayley graph of that group is the graph which is just dual to this tessellation of hyperbolic space. So what kind of graphs are we going to study percolation on? Graphs which are staring at you from this. It turns out that on a tree, percolation is very easy to study. The deterministic geodesic is the same as the geodesic of first passage percolation, independent. The underlying edge path is the same, independent of which little omega you choose. That's not so when you go to some other place, say like the round picture, the round disk picture at the top. Yeah. So perhaps one of the reasons why percolation on hyperbolic groups was not studied too much is basically because there is a slightly misleading example. The base example is much too simple. And so it was not clear how much of this complicated, I mean, how rich the theory is. And even now, I think it's pretty wide open. But I think the first steps have already been taken. Okay, good. So now let's get to trying to say what can we say about percolation on hyperbolic groups? Okay, fine. Now, here's the thing. In Euclidean space, for every point and given a direction, there's a unique geodesic which goes off to infinity. Yeah. And so essentially, you can ask, how fast does the percolation go in that particular direction? So essentially, what does that mean? You take a sequence of points on a ray at angle theta at the origin, and you take, say, basically x comma tan theta x. Yeah, tan theta x comma, what is it? Yeah, x comma tan theta x. Yeah, so basically x comma y moving along that line going off to infinity, and you just take a sequence of x's which go off to infinity, and you ask for the percolation geodesic which joins your origin 0, 0 to that point and study its behavior as n tends to infinity, as the thing goes very far away. So this is somehow parameterizing directions in this percolation context. Fine. Well, what about hyperbolic space? Now we have a graph. There is no infinitesimal set sense of directions here. However, what comes to our rescue is essentially, this is a certain motif that keeps figuring in this area called coarse geometry. What you can't do at an infinitesimal level, you invert your point of view so that your set of directions now are positioned at infinity. Behind all this, there's a classical theorem of Cartan and Hadamard from maybe the early 20th or late 19th century, which basically says that if you have a manifold of non-positive curvature, if the curvature is less than or equal to zero, then the collection of tangents, so any two geodesics starting at a point in two different directions never meet. which means you can assign to every direction a point at infinity, and this assignment is a bijection between the infinitesimal and the space at infinity. So essentially every geodesic, infinite geodesic ray assigns for you a point at infinity, and this assignment is in one-to-one correspondence with the infinitesimal notion of directions that we know and love. When you come to a hyperbolic group, all the infinitesimal structure has been thrown into the dustbin. In a graph, you have just finitely many directions at a point, the number of the collection of edges. On the other hand, you would like to say there's a nice continuous whole. So let me just get back to the... So in the tree picture, you can think, and this is really what is going on. You have this tree. What is happening is that the space at infinity is like a dust. Yeah. And that space is basically a Cantor set. Yeah. So this Cantor set parameterizes the collection of directions in this tree at infinity. Similarly, in this hyperbolic plane, you have your origin, and geodesics go off and you get your circle at infinity. That circle is, this is really a case of Cartan-Hadamard. You have this boundary circle, which is in one-to-one correspondence with a small infinitesimal circle at your origin. Yeah. So what we'll do is, in order to parameterize directions, we will use this coarse Cartan-Hadamard version and essentially parameterize our directions by points at infinity, not infinitesimal directions. All right, good. So the key feature, as we may have mentioned just now, is that every hyperbolic group has a boundary, and this boundary comes with a nice group action. Again, this is something that's very different from the Euclidean case. For example, if you have Z plus Z, there also you have directions, right? But Z plus Z acts on the space of directions, preserving them on the nose. Yeah, it does not flip any direction. Translations move directions parallel to themselves. So the action on the space at infinity of Z plus Z is the identity. It's every group element acts by the identity on the boundary. Yeah. So it does not help you to think of directions at infinity when you are thinking of Euclidean case. But in the case of hyperbolic group, there's a very lovely action of G on the boundary. So in particular, this is what is called ergodicity. We'll come to that later on. But anyway, for time being, you think of this hyperbolic group equipped with their boundary at infinity. Use this boundary now to parameterize directions. And now you're out. The question that we are asking is a very basic question. Oh, hang on. But it's not. So this boundary actually has a lot of extra structure. The boundary comes with a nice topology. And it comes with a nice measure. The measure is a very simple-minded thing. This is called the Patterson-Sullivan measure because Patterson and Sullivan came up with it, and then it was generalized to hyperbolic groups by Cournet. What is the measure? You look at the probability measure, the uniform probability measure on balls of radius n. Yeah. So take a ball of radius n, and you assign every point a mass uniform over all points of the ball such that the total mass becomes one. So what is happening is really the mass at every point is going to zero as n goes to infinity. And as a consequence of hyperbolicity, what happens is that when you take a limit of these measures, the entire measure now gets pushes off to infinity. So the entire measure, this weak limit of uniform measures, is now supported on the boundary. This is called the Patterson-Sullivan measure. And so when we are going to be talking about, about the problem in measure theoretic or probabilistic language, right? So there will be a use of almost every. So when we are saying almost every with respect to direction, we basically mean almost every with respect to the Patterson-Sullivan measure on the boundary. But when we are talking about almost every omega geodesic, yeah, there we are looking at our parameterization space, capital omega P. Yeah, so carry in mind that there are these two different senses, two different probability measures, which come up for very different reasons. One as a measure, as a parameterization space, and the other as a probability measure space at infinity of the group that you're studying. All right. So this is a way of saying what direction, what is, and saying almost every direction. Now, the question that we are going to be first, and I'll be able to state what we are trying to prove here. So the first question that we want to ask is something pretty naive. See, you just think of one deterministic geodesic ray going off to infinity. Or essentially think of a sequence of points in your hyperbolic metric space which converge to a fixed point xi at infinity. Now you take these, say, call this sequence of points xn. Join your origin to xn now by a random geodesic, which means geodesics parameterized by your probability measure space. Pass to the limit as n tends to infinity. Now you're going to get some collection of paths. Yeah, for each little omega, you're going to get some, every subsequent limit of these paths is going to give you an omega geodesic, an FPP geodesic. Question is, what can you say about this random path? Does it have a direction? How are you going to make sense of that? We don't have infinitesimal calculus available to us. So what we say is the crudest possible thing. A path starting at O has direction xi, where what is xi? Xi is a point in the boundary G. Provided the only accumulation point of this path in the boundary G is only sigma. So which means it doesn't go near some other point and then come back to your point xi, then goes again close to some third point, comes back to xi. So the only limit point that you have is this unique guy xi towards which you were heading. And here is the first theorem under, again, very mild conditions. What happens is that given any xi and you take a sequence of points converging to xi, then for almost every omega, okay, so the quantification should be more precise and you get a really stronger result. Given xi belonging to boundary G, then for almost every little omega belonging to your measure space, you choose now any sequence of points xn converging to xi, the sequence of omega geodesics, that means the FPP geodesics joining 0 xn to omega from 0 to xn converges to a ray having direction xi. Okay, so first basic point is saying, this is the sort of the first thing which allows us to determine directions, which says that if your deterministic direction is given by xi, then your random direction is also given by xi. So deterministic equal to random. That's basically what this is saying, which essentially says that even if you introduce this probability to fudge out your lengths, to make your lengths distributed, you are not going to disturb the overall geometry at infinity of the space. Sure, the geodesics might wander around a lot before heading off to infinity, but as you head off to infinity, you're going to converge to this unique point towards which you were headed. Yeah, so you can take detours, but you come home to the direction where you were headed. So randomness does not affect things at infinity as far as directions of FPP geodesics go. So basically, random geodesics behave asymptotically like deterministic geodesics is the moral of this first story. Good. So once you have that direction exists for almost every for almost every geodesic parameterized by your probability measure space, now we've become a little more greedy. We want essentially not just convergence to infinity, we want also some kind of estimate on the speed of convergence. And here we'll be pretty cavalier and we'll define velocity in a way in which will give physicists nightmares. So we'll define it as time divided by distance rather than distance divided by time. But there's a reason for it. We'll just come to that. So here's the thing. Given a pair of points, there's an expected distance between them. So given a pair of points x and y, you recall that there was this first passage time random variable, which what did it do? It ate a point of your probability measure space little omega and spat out the distance between them in that particular metric, in the metric given by omega. Now you have a probability measure space, you have a probability measure P on it, and you just integrate out that object and you get the expected passage time from x to y. So now it depends only on x and y and you have integrated out the randomness. So this is our expected random object. This is the coming from probability. Now you already have a deterministic distance, namely your dxy. So what you do is you can divide this expected passage time divide by distance. This is called a passage time constant, but we prefer to call it velocity. We call it velocity basically because all the action is really happening on the numerator. The deterministic guy is not changing given x and y. So for xi belonging to boundary G, you define the velocity in the direction of xi to be the limit of the probabilistic object divided by the deterministic object. Yeah. So take a sequence of points xn going off to xi, take the expected passage time divided by the deterministic distance, take a limit as n tends to infinity, and you call that limit v xi, velocity in the direction of xi. And there is a crucial caveat, provided the limit exists. Yeah. So essentially, if the limit does not exist, we won't be able to say anything about velocity. So this velocity is going to accumulate to some bunch of numbers, and no velocity is determined. Yeah. And so here is the thing. Suppose now we'll start imposing some assumptions on our probability distribution rho. Yeah. So we've already assumed that rho is a continuous probability distribution, which means it has no atoms. Yeah. The statement actually is more general, but we'll give you just one class of probability distributions. The class of probability distributions are sub-Gaussian. Yeah. That means if you multiply by e power ax square and you integrate out, this guy is the integral is finite, which means that it behaves more or less like a Gaussian. Yeah. With some parameters. Yeah? So if you have this assumption, then the conclusion is that for almost every with respect to what? With respect to the Patterson-Sullivan measure, the velocity v xi in the direction of xi exists. Yeah? So note that we have integrated out. So expectation now, it does not depend on the parameterization space anymore. What this says is that you do have this velocity. Though our first theorem basically said that these random geodesics behaved like deterministic geodesics asymptotically. They had the same direction as the asymptotic geodesic. What the second theorem basically says is that the speed at which it converges to infinity, at which it goes to infinity, that is also something determined. Yeah, there is a velocity. And now we come to a basic crucial difference. This kind of velocity could also be measured in the Euclidean case. Yes, you have these deterministic geodesics which go off in different directions in Euclidean space, and you could run the same kind of argument. And their velocity also exists, but there's a crucial difference, and the crucial difference comes from the second part of this theorem. The second part of the theorem says that this velocity is constant almost everywhere, which means two things. One, it does not depend on xi, but it does not depend on xi up to a set of measures zero in this Patterson-Sullivan class. Yeah. There is a crucial difference between this and the Euclidean setup. In the Euclidean setup, the velocity v xi actually exists everywhere, modulo some very minor, some small assumptions. And the velocity is very different from direction to direction. Yeah. So there are two points of difference in this. There's an analogous theorem for Euclidean case where velocity exists everywhere, but it's very far from constant. There's a function. Yeah? Here, it does not exist almost everywhere. It does not exist everywhere. It exists only almost everywhere. And the velocity is constant. Yeah? And this is really, this is really a nature of the problem. It is not possible to upgrade. There are counterexamples to show that you cannot upgrade this almost every to a statement about every point on the boundary. Yeah. It's a fact of life. You can't get away with it. Get away from it. All right. So that's the second thing. So what have we established so far? Geodesics have a direction. Random geodesics have the same direction as classical geodesics. And along these guys, velocity exists. Now, here is a feature which is, so far we were distinguishing between the probabilistic study in the Euclidean case. Now we'll try to distinguish certain features of this percolation model which is from the deterministic study of hyperbolic groups. Yeah. And here is the basic issue, something called coalescence. Basically, let me sort of say in words what it means. What does it mean for two paths to coalesce? It basically means you have two fellows who start from probably very far away. They are headed in the same direction, Xi. And they coalesce if after some finite amount of time, they come together and then they proceed on that path together. More formally, if you have two semi-infinite paths, which means sigma 1 and sigma 2, which start at, say, points x1 and x2, they are said to coalesce if beyond some point x0, they actually coincide on the nose. Okay? That means they travel, they do not diverge away from each other and then converge again or go off in different directions. That's not possible. So once they meet, they stay together for all of future time. So here is a basic fact that in first passage percolation, again, this is something that is similar to Euclidean case. But in the Euclidean case, you need much harder assumptions than this. So for almost every omega in your probability measure space, given any two base points in your G, and any direction Xi, yeah? Oh boy. I have quantified it terribly. This gives you a very wrong notion of what I'm supposed to be saying. What I should be saying is the following. Given any direction Xi, first fix the direction Xi, then for almost every little omega belonging to the capital omega. So this full measure set depends on Xi, which is completely, I have not stated it that way. So given a direction Xi for almost every omega belonging to your parameterization space, you start off at any two points O1, O2, then the omega geodesic rays from O1 towards Xi and O2 towards Xi almost surely coalesce. Yeah. Which means given Xi, so it's no longer almost surely. They do coalesce. So given, so if you I think I stated it in this convoluted way. The correct way to state it is, given a direction Xi for almost every omega belonging to capital omega, you start off your omega geodesics at any two points, O1, O2, then they are going to surely coalesce. Yeah. Which means, this is again a difference between the random geometry of hyperbolic spaces and the deterministic geometry of hyperbolic spaces. What happens in a hyperbolic group G is that you can start off at two different points, O1, O2. Then depending on that hyperbolicity constant delta, that means two geodesics, our triangles are delta thin, which means a bigon, which means a pair of geodesics which start and end at the same point. These are degenerate triangles. So what does that delta give you? It basically says that any two geodesics which start and end at the same point lie within a delta neighborhood of each other. Now, if you push that point off to infinity, the constant becomes slightly worse, but not much. Essentially, if you have two geodesic rays starting off at two different points, O1 and O2, and they're headed towards the same point, Xi, at infinity, then eventually they lie within some 3 delta or 8 delta of each other. Let's say 8 delta to be safe. So it is some, they lie within a uniformly bounded distance from each other. On the other hand, this coalescence property says, no, it's not just they lie within some uniformly bounded distance of each other. They coincide on the nose. Yeah. So essentially they lie within, so you reduce this 8 delta to 0. And independent of what hyperbolic group, whether your delta was 10 million or 20 million or a billion, whatever, you don't care. Eventually, these guys must coincide and they'll coalesce and proceed off to infinity. Okay? So this is a feature of, again, random geodesics in hyperbolic space. So if you are headed in the same direction, eventually everybody comes together. Okay? All right. So yeah. And this the final statement that we want to say is, okay, fine. So first, what did we get? We had this expected passage time, right? This expected passage time was a first order estimate. What was it doing? you took your random guy, which was your passage, which was your first passage time, and you looked, integrated it out over the whole probability measure space, and you got an expected passage time. That was some number. Question is, what about second order behavior? Yeah. So this is basically variance. So second order behavior, which is namely the first, so you take a point, take a geodesic ray again, yeah, and now let Xn lie on that geodesic and go off to infinity, yeah. So now you have this random variable, t of 1 comma Xn. So think of Xn as a point on some geodesic ray starting at 1 at distance n from it, yeah. How does the variance of this passage time t, yeah, behave with n? Again, the feature that we are going to say, this was conjectured, but it's very different from what happens in Euclidean space. And the thing is, it grows linearly with n. Here is the formal theorem. There exists some constants, C1 and C2, which, yeah, greater than zero and less than infinity, such that the variance in this passage time, T1xn, that's some measurable function, so it has a variance, it has an expectation which was related to our velocity, but the variance is bounded away from zero by a linear function of n and bounded away from infinity by another linear function of n. So this linear variance of the passage time had been conjectured by Benjamini, Tessera, and Zitouni, and so this theorem answers that conjecture affirmatively. So I'll stop here. Thank you very much. And I think I'm 3 minutes before time, but I don't want to get into the proofs now. Thanks.
Wonderful presentation, Professor Mahan. And now it's open for questions. And I'll first ask the people here in the seminar room, if you have any questions for Mahan.
I have a question, Manjana.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if you go back a few slides where you said it can't be in every direction, so you had some statement about that.
That's right. That's right. Yes. This is the statement, right? Not possible to upgrade almost every psi to every psi, right?
So are you saying there is a random geodesic, random psi where it fails, or a deterministic psi where it fails?
No. So the thing is, here is the point. No, this psi is not a random psi. So essentially you can nail down. So let me sort of say what's going on. So you can by hand construct directions in which you will not have velocity.
I see.
So yeah. So here is the thing. Think of, and the example is quite simple minded. So essentially think of the tree. Yeah. And assume that, you can massage your graph in a certain way. So essentially think of the free group. Again, it's the simplest case. Free group itself gives you counterexamples. So think of generators not A and B in that free group on two generators. Think of some extra things. So A, B, and B square. Mm-hmm. So the Cayley graph along the B square direction, it's quasi-isometric to Z, but it's a little fatter. What happens is that in that direction, the passage time becomes the deterministic distance becomes less, so your velocity probably becomes more or something like that. Essentially, what happens is that the velocity in the A direction and the velocity in the B direction become different.
Okay.
Once you force that, see, essentially the thing is, if you have two different directions in which velocity is different, in a hyperbolic space, you can now manufacture a direction where the limit will just not exist. How do you do that? So basically, you look at A power 10, B power 10 power 10, A power 10 power 10 power 10. So essentially, you keep taking towers. So that all the whole tail becomes very small in length compared to the last term that you get. So what is happening is that this is going to give you a geodesic where the velocity is going to keep oscillating between the velocity that is there in the A direction and the velocity that is there in the B direction. So essentially, this particular deterministic direction, which you construct by hand, you can say that in that direction, this velocity will not exist.
But are there many situations where the boundary is homogeneous in some sense? In those cases, you don't have problems, right?
No. So here is the thing. Okay. So that's a good question. It's a very good question. the group, see, for example, the circle, it is homogeneous in one sense. So, for example, the circle is acted upon transitively by SL2R. That's the isometry group of the hyperbolic plane. However, we are looking at only this discrete gadget, namely this gamma. Yeah. So, when gamma acts on the boundary, it does not act transitively. So, basically, it's not gamma homogeneous. It is homogeneous under a bigger group inside which gamma sits. So the orbit under every gamma, under the group gamma, a point actually goes to only a dense set. So the same thing happens just in the tree also. You have this free group on two generators. It acts densely. And this constancy is basically because of ergodicity of this action. There is no proper subset with measure away from zero and infinity, which is invariant under the group. That's what gives you this constancy almost everywhere. But the action is never homogeneous. I mean, never homogeneous in the sense that it's topologically homogeneous. Every point under the group action is going to give you a countable dense set. But countable density does not give you diddly in the measure theoretic world. So that's really the source of the problem. Yeah. So, I mean, this velocity does not exist is really a fact of life. I mean, there might be. So essentially, we have no real way of answering this question affirmatively, but let me throw it out there in any case. If you take the free group with the genuine generating set A and B, yeah. So you don't pad the generator. So you get a genuine tree. Then really your velocity is constant everywhere. And we expect that's really the only case. Yeah. So if you can upgrade this almost every to every, you should be able to say that you are in a very restrictive situation, namely on a tree. We don't really know. I mean, that's really a very homogeneous situation, which really does not happen anywhere else. This is related to, I mean, well, phenomenon is related to essentially there's something in the random walks world, which says that you look at the hitting measure of the random walk on a hyperbolic group, and that is typically singular with respect to this. So the harmonic measure and this measure, this Patterson-Sullivan measure is what's called a quasi-conformal measure. So the group acts by these quasi-conformal transformations. So the hitting measure, which is this the harmonic measure and this quasi-conformal measure are always singular with respect to each other unless the group is free with the standard generating set. So there is some, we suspect that this upgrading Xi almost every to every is going to impose very severe restrictions on not just the group, but the particular generating set that you chose.
Thanks.
Uh-huh. Okay, great. Thanks.
From the Zoom users, you can mute yourself. Question?
Yeah.
YouTube chat questions?
There is no questions from YouTube channel.
For many people.
Yeah, Kalyan, I mean, I think your audibility has gone down a little bit.
Yeah, so it's clear now. So thank you so much, Professor Mahan. And
yeah, it was my pleasure. Yeah, thank you.
To go into research into this particular area. And so we wish that once things normalize, Professor Mahan, you will be visiting us.
I would love to. I like Kerala very much. I mean, like Kesom very much. Yeah, love to visit at some point. Yeah. Okay, bye.